Radio for readers, Bookmark.
This is Bookmark. I'm Marc Bernier. The nation's top authors are coming up next. Now, gratitude and trust. Both Tracey Jackson, Paul Williams join us here at the Miami Book Fair. It's good to see both of you. Thanks for visiting with us today.
Thanks for having us, Mark.
Thank you.
Remarkable talent and a story. How did you come to this collaborative effort?
Well, Paul has been sober for 24 years, and we all know the talents of Paul Williams, and I am a screenwriter and author, and I have not been an addict in terms of drugs and alcohol, but I've always felt that recovery was for everybody. I had recovery envy. So Paul and I decided that the world would be a better place if more people had the steps of recovery to go by. So we've written this book, Gratitude and Trust, originally called Recovery is Not Just for Addicts,
It's called Gratitude and Trust, Six Affirmations That Will Change Your Life. For 24 years, you know, I got sober when I was 49. I'm 74 now. When I got sober, I had missed the 80s were gone for me. You know you're an alcoholic when you misplace a decade, you know.
I heard this from Sid Caesar. During all your works of the 80s, you have trouble remembering?
Yeah, the 80s, well, most of the 80s I was home hiding out, you know. I really wasn't very productive. The 70s were an amazing time for me and all, but for the first time in my life when I really, you know, I did rehab twice. The first time I did it for some girl, the second time I did it for me. And when I did it for me, everything in my life changed. And when I reached out to people I didn't know, hit my knees and said, I don't know what I'm doing. I desperately need some help. All of a sudden, I made a connection with the world that I had never made before, on a level that I'd never made before. And my life opened up and kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It's an amazing life today. And Tracey and I met years ago in Robert Mitchum's bedroom when I was a rude little drunk. And then she saw me again in 2001 when I was fairly acceptable. She went, major change. We became friends. And after a screening of my documentary, Paul Williams Still Alive, I was speaking. And I said that my choo-choo runs on the twin rails of gratitude and trust, and she went, there's a book there.
Good for you. And how perceptive, too.
Well, I think that everyone, you know, we all have problems, and we're all addicted to something. And I think there's nobody out there. And as we go around speaking, we always say in the room, you know, has anyone ever said, this is my last? And it's really hard to find someone, whether it be, you know, sugar, whether it be women, whether it be using their cell phone, you know, 24/7, and we'll take that cell phone. So it's also about self-sabotage. It's about people who just turn their lives around in general. Everyone's got something, and everyone can just use a little more gratitude and trust, you know? Trust is the firewall to fear. Fear motivates most people, and it really gets in their way.
What was the amount of time, Paul, between the first try at sobriety and the second? How much of a gap?
You know, I was about 2 years. There were 7 months when I was on my own, white-knuckling it. I had what we call sobriety. Not sobriety, it was sobriety. 7 months, I was just absolutely going to be fine. I wasn't drinking. I had a big cocaine addiction as well. So it was like, no cocaine, no alcohol. I'm just fine. I was far from fine. I went to Jamaica, and somebody walked by at a particular moment and said, would you like a rum and coke? And it was one of those wonderful moments where you just went, absolutely, and my addiction said I can handle, or my ego said you can handle one. I had one. At 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I joked that I had one rum and coke. At 2 o'clock in the morning, I was at Bob Marley's grave explaining reggae to a lot of black people that I didn't know. I went, oh, wait a minute. And so I was off and running, and I was out for 2 years. 2 years. So when I had that last drink in 1989, I had done some. Most of the damage I had been done had been in my absence. My absence as a father, my absence as a friend, my inability to keep a promise. And the fact is that when I'm drinking and using, if my mouth is moving, there's a good chance I'm lying to hide my addiction. I became a chronic and habitual liar. And then the lights were turned on. And when the lights were turned on, everything changed.
You have had this brilliant mind, so well respected and loved by your friends as well as your industry partners. Did they stay with you through the second time, or did you lose friends?
Well, I was so isolated that so many of the friends were already gone, you know, by the time I finally got sober. So one of the things you're told is you have to change everything. If you have the life-threatening disease of alcoholism and drug addiction to the level that I did, you should pretty much change everything. The black book of names and pals supposedly were, first of all, a lot of them were dead. you know, and so many, like, sweeter souls have not survived from this terrible, terrible disease. But I changed everything, and I embraced the recovering community. I went to UCLA, and I got my certification as a drug and alcohol counselor. I entered into what I refer to as the Pauli Lama period of my life. So I came to this thing when Tracey said, let's write this book. I had a really solid sense of what an amazing gift it was, and the only thing we're asked is to give it away. You get to keep the miracle by giving it away. So she found a way for us to do it.
Tracey, did you find that you needed to test him through any of this in writing this thing?
To test him, his principles?
Yes.
I didn't need to test his principles. I think I needed to make him... Paul's a great public speaker, and he's spoken all around the world in recovery, and he's a great songwriter. I think, and he'd be the first to admit it, that the discipline of writing a book and writing a song are vastly different.
No kidding.
So, you know, how many layers deep you have to go in a book is very, and how long you have to stick at it and sit in the chairs, everyone who's in this fair can attest to here today. So that, I think, that was the bigger challenge. It was really just getting the information out of him in a longer form, but that and making him go deeper than normal. That's the other thing is, you know, prose has to really go to a place sometimes that a song can go by what it intimates, by an emotion it captures in 3 minutes. When you got 228 pages to fill with words, you know, you really gotta. It's a longer climb. You know, it's not a sprint. It's really kind of a marathon, and I think that's the difference. And that would be probably I would think you would say is the bigger difference of the two mm-hmm. disciplines.
It was phenomenal to watch her work. I mean, she'd sit there for 8 hours, smoke coming out of her, not even looking up. It's just flying through. And again, years and years and years of 3 hour sessions writing. But the thing that I heard that was the greatest gift was what she just repeated: go deeper. Because I'd write something from here. Everything that ever succeeded for me as a songwriter came from here. The really bright, witty, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful songs I wrote from up here that are clever and witty, and the lyrics are, what an amazing rhyme, wind up in a drawer nobody really cares about. But if I write honestly from the center of my chest about what I'm experiencing, people have always responded to it. What Tracey did, one of the great things she did, and she did it again and again and again, was I would... you know, make some sort of, you know, a global assessment about what it was like to, you know, to lose my dad to a car wreck when I was 13 and be shipped off to live with an aunt and uncle, and she would say, no, go deeper. What did it feel like to wake up in a guest room bed of the people that you never met before, to have lost your entire family when you're 13? They gave me shots that, you know, to try to make me grow when I was 9 years old. They had the opposite effect. So all of a sudden, I'm this tiny little guy. I was 4'6" when I got out of high school. I'm 5'2" now. But, I mean, and my body clock was way slowed down, so I didn't hit puberty until I was, like, in my early 20s.
Wow.
So I was so different from the rest of the world. What did it feel like? What did it feel like? And what it felt like is in the book, and that's a gift from her.
Tracey, what was it like with your network of people if you've known? When you announced you're in this project and it comes out, what's their reaction?
That I'm involved in a book about recovery?
Yes.
Well, I think that I've changed. I've done a lot of different things. My last book was somewhat of a self-help book, so I don't know that people were surprised. I think sometimes people will say, I didn't know you were an addict. I think that the first assumption people make when you write a book about recovery is that you're an addict. One of the things that I really hope, you know, the conversation that comes out of this, Mark, and I think one of the things that's really a problem with people who are addicts of substance compared to the rest of us who are just run-of-the-mill, what we call life-limiting behavior patterns, is that there's a stigma attached, and it's an isolating thing. And so you find people, and the people we've lost this year, even examples, Philip Seymour Hoffman, you know, the list is on and on. They become isolated, and the more they become isolated, the more they use and the more they feel different. If the conversation opens that we're all in this together, that there's less of a stigma attached to being an addict, that it is a disease, that's another big thing that we're trying to accomplish. So, you know, we spoke at Betty Ford 2 weeks ago, and someone said to me in the elevator, I said, well, they see that you're here for the conference. They said, so you're part of Betty Ford, so you're an alcoholic. And I immediately wanted to say, no, I'm not an alcoholic. You know, I found myself going to that place, and I just said, no, it's fine. I just left it alone. And I think that we do that sometimes. You know, no, I'm not an addict. This book has taught me, writing this, the process of it, working with people, and I work with a lot of people who have problems on a daily basis through our website. It's taught me great patience and great empathy and not judge. And I think that that's one of the big things we do in this country. We judge.
If I may, I wanted to leave the book for just a moment to compliment you on how I heard you speak the other day concerning a separate issue. I want to come back to the book about ASCAP and your role there. And Is it going to be harder, Paul, for entertainers, musicians to be paid with all of these different platforms? How are you going to regulate it so you do get paid for your work?
Well, we've been licensing, the ASCAP is a performing rights organization, the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers. We have 520,000 members, and we blanket license, we license the 100 years worth of music from Irving Berlin to Beyonce, to, Justin Bieber, to Cole Porter, Gershwin, the American Songbook. And at every introduction of any new way that music is delivered, radio, television, cable, whatever, we've always had to first establish a right. We have the right to collect that. When that music is played and you sell advertising around that music, we have a right to a small percentage of that advertising money or the subscription money. It's especially challenging in the digital world. Is the quick answer is it's going to get better. The stream is the dream, and it should not be a nightmare for the people that are creating the music. The fact there are two copyrights. When a song is written, you copyright the song. When it's recorded, the recording of that material is also copyrighted. What's out of balance right now is that the record company and the artists receive 12 to 14 times more than the music creators. And that's what's out of balance. We don't, incidentally, want the people that are enjoying the music to pay any more. We want the people that are building businesses around our music and delivering it to the general public to give us a more fair share.
For example, restaurants that play music by performers who are copyrighted.
Yeah, absolutely, and we have a great deal with bars and grills is under general licensing. That's great and all. Cable started out with pennies coming in for a performance on cable, and it's $300 million or something a year. It's a huge a part of what we earn and distribute to our members. We are a not-for-profit organization. We are a membership-owned organization. We operate at about 12% operating costs, which is unheard of in other PROs. So every dollar that is collected, 88 cents of the dollar is shipped off immediately to the music creator.
I want to come back to the topic. I have to say, when you said you were 74 years old, I found it astonishing because I still don't think of you. And that I've been a fan my whole broadcast life.
Thank you, Mom.
Played your music on radio stations and always thought, what an incredible talent. I did not know, Paul, for the longest time that you had the disease.
Oh, yeah. Well, and the fact is that I don't blame my behavior on the disease. Incidentally, I have to take responsibility for my actions. One of our affirmations is I will learn from my mistakes and not defend them. So there's a great deal of information for me in the process of looking at my life, looking at the mistakes, which we outline in the book. We take you through that process where you can look at your life and the things that are keeping you up at night. Tracey has a great expression about being an emotional
Sherpa.
An emotional Sherpa.
Oh, really?
I mean, which is just perfect because these feelings of guilt begin to pile up based on our bad behavior, because there was a lot of bad behavior, Mark. But fortunately, I'm able to go back and clean it up and rid myself of that excess baggage. That emotional Sherpa experience is beginning to disappear in my life.
Tracey and Paul, who do you want to see this book, to read this book, that doesn't know about it yet?
Well, it's a blanket statement. We want everyone to see this book. Because,
right, but wrote for people, too, that had not dealt with the issue.
Well, we have, I would say, Mark, it's split really pretty much down the middle of our readership and our followers, that half of them probably fall under the heading of people who've been in recovery and are keeping their recovery going. And then there's a portion who just have, they picked the wrong man. They keep sabotaging their jobs. They've woken up at a point in their life and they don't know where they're going. Their life is kind of a weird Lego construction of bad choices, and they're trying to unravel those and put them back together. And then we have people and these are who come in and they say, I didn't know I had a problem until I started reading this book. We have people who need to be in a 12-step program who read this book and it's their first step. So it's a very broad base, and that's, I think, what's the most exciting for us. We didn't realize how far. We have ministers who are reading this book, priests.
I was just going to ask, is there a spiritual component
to
this?
Very spiritual. We've done surprisingly, a big surprise to both of us. The conservative Catholic movement has picked up this book in a big way.
Yeah.
Conservative Christians picked this up in a big way, which was not, things that we didn't expect, but they really, it's a very widespread net that we seem to have been able to cast. And there's very few people, pretty much, if you go on all the reviews, even the reviews have been saying, it's pretty much, if no matter who you are, there's some nugget in that book that will, that'll maybe change your life or point you in a direction where you can. It's great for kids. It's great for parenting. It's great for just owning your stuff. You know, it just makes your lives better. Even now, you know, I would love to say that Thanksgiving is coming up. How many people are dreading going home at the same amount of time that they're looking forward to it? You know, I mean, holidays are really stressful with family members, the family members who can push your buttons. We have a whole thing on this, on dealing with family members that push your buttons and how they're probably not, maybe you're, maybe
navigating,
you're really,
the nasty.
Maybe, you're, maybe your difficult cousin, you know, Sam is not going to change and he may really torture you over the holidays, but you can change and he's going to respond to you in a very different way.
That's the first affirmation. Something needs to change, and it's probably me. The second one addresses the spiritual component you're talking about. I don't know how to do this, but something inside me does. I don't know how to do this, but something inside me does. It's that inner, you know, that, you know, that inner invisible ally that you've managed to find that gives you that sense of comfort to go forward and move through the thing. The other thing about the book that I think is something we should mention more is it's like three books, because we write the text of the program as we lay it out in like one voice, but then we step into our own boxes to tell of our own personal experiences. So you know, my journey into sobriety was through a traditional recovery method and an organization that I don't mention on the air. I don't mention them by name on the air. That's one of the traditions of that organization. So we don't talk about that organization. But we looked at going back to the Oxford group and Hinduism, Buddhism, Judeo-Christian ethics and all that wind up being a part of this thing. But in the individual boxes, there's a lot of polymista. There's a lot of mud on the carpet and there's mud on my boots, and those stories are in the book as well.
I'm going to say something I never say in an interview. I'm buying the audio version because I'll be able to listen to it in the car, because I think this is perhaps the most inspiring team effort I've seen this year. And I am so thrilled that I got a chance to bump into both of you.
Chills. Yeah, well, we're very, you know, but that's a lovely thing to hear. And if we can make people's burden a little lighter, you know, if we can help them, especially through this, I really do, you know, I believe that, especially through this difficult holiday season, because there's a lot of sadness and a lot of isolation and loneliness that takes place around the holidays, a lot of expectations. We talk a lot about expectations and what they do to you. And so, you know, if we can help people get through this and other things in their lives, then we've done our job that day.
One of the nice things we're hearing is we travel around the country and we talk to people, and oddly enough, a lot of the people working in radio, we run into a lot of long-term sobriety. Hmm. And what we've heard a couple times that is just, I mean, to me, it's my favorite comment that I get from somebody that's got 28 years sobriety that said, I read the book, I'm now going back through it a second time because I found a lot of stuff I didn't take care of before that this book has taken me back to. It shines some light on some dark corners of my life that need to be dealt with.
And we have someone with 51 years sobriety who said that.
Exactly.
You know, so it's really, it's for everybody, Mark. This book is for everybody. I mean, I'm not an alcohol or drug abuser. I've had anxiety, really difficult family situations. I mean, it works for everything. None of us are clean in this world.
If you are somebody listening and you have a son or a husband or a friend or a relative, whatever, that is an addict and you don't know how to deal with it, there's a chapter called The Ones We Love in the book, which kind of outlines what is really the healthy way to handle somebody that just doesn't seem to want to change. Takes you through the process of trying to you know, get involved in a healthy way at a certain point, and when to walk away and take care, and do what you have to do, which is take care of yourself, set up the realistic boundaries for dealing with that alcoholic or that addict that will not change, and take care of yourself. But it's a chapter that I think everybody that I've ever talked to has something in someone in their life that is just a mess.
And also gratitude. I think, you know, now especially, winter's coming, the holidays are coming, there's so many people who don't have anything that if you in doing for others, it really shines your soul and you stop thinking about your own problems. So this time of year, people go out and help those who have less than you. You know, it's really a good time to do that, and you won't find yourself not focusing on maybe what you think you don't have. I think that's a big one.
You just mentioned that you just went right to our sixth affirmation.
I will live my life in love and service, gratitude and trust.
I will live my life in love and service, gratitude and trust.
Tracey Jackson, Paul Williams, in the most important interview we will have done today, and I thank you for making it with us today.
That touches me.
Really?
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
That's all the best.
Nice.
Stay in good health. Best of luck.
God bless.
You too.
That's Bookmark for this week. If you have comments or thoughts on future authors, send an email to us at our website, bookmark.us. That's our broadcast for today. Thanks for watching.